All right, welcome everyone to my first ever draft preview for the best damn Dynasty League ever. So today I wanted to do a quick rundown of some of the prospects that will be drafted on Thursday's first round. And I wanted to do this in a way where I was giving some useful information while also highlighting players that you could be looking for to be drafted. It's very important for you to know that I am not giving you any of my opinions. I'm not trying to specifically highlight players. I'm not trying to specifically downgrade players that I like, and none of the opinions are mine. I really just wanted to highlight players based on mock drafts that I found in the industry. Let me first go through a little bit of what my process was. I looked at 5 mock drafts from prominent draft analysts. I looked at mock drafts from Evan Silva, Daniel Jeremiah, Mel Kiper, Charles Davis, and Peter Schrager. I'm highlighting all players at least one analyst has projected to be drafted in the first round. I'm then presenting the player profiler page for each one of those so that you can see information about the player's production in college and also their performance during the combine. Lastly, I'm giving a little bit more context on the players by looking at some of the comments that Sigmund Bloom posted on footballguys.com. So you can just get a little bit of a feel of how the players look on the field, just kind of some of the archetypes of what those players are. We can get right into it. So with the first pick of the 2020 NFL draft, the Cincinnati Bengals select. It doesn't matter because they're still the Bengals. All right. That was a little bit of a Browns joke there. All right. The first player expected to go off the board by everybody is Joe Burrow. Joe Burrow projects to be a quality passer inside and outside of structure. He also has the ability to add with his legs. You'll see here that he did not run at the combine, so we won't see any performance that would indicate that in the chart for the workout metrics, but he did show that while he was at LSU. He also has projected to be in a very good supporting cast in Cincinnati, which will give him a lot of weapons to potentially perform right away. One red flag, and one that a lot of people in the draft community really care about, is hand size, and Joe Burrow had some of the smallest hands that we've ever seen for a first-round quarterback. So that'll be really interesting to see if that actually matters or not, but a lot of people get really interested about that. One other thing I wanted to point out is that, like I mentioned, I looked at 5 mock drafts. Here I will be highlighting the earliest that someone got projected, the latest that someone got projected, and then the median projection. So for Joe Burrow, everybody is projecting to go first, so that's where you'll see first here in every single one of them. But later on, you'll see that those numbers will vary. Now, the first bit of suspense on Thursday night will be, which is the second quarterback to be drafted? Right now, most are projecting that Justin Herbert will go to the Miami Dolphins with the 5th overall pick. The thought is that the quarterbacks will go off the board in the 5th and 6th picks with the Dolphins and the Chargers. But what will be really interesting is if somebody looks to trade up to get either Herbert or Tua. That would be where we would see some suspense, or we see some things that are a little bit outside of what the guys can mock at this time. So next up is Justin Herbert from Oregon. Sigmund Bloom says that Herbert has all of the individual pieces to be a franchise quarterback, but he is less than the sum of his parts. One thing the teams will be very interested in is that he has the ability to use his legs to gain yards and escape sacks. You can see from his workout numbers that he had an extremely high 40-yard dash and burst score. Obviously, in today's NFL, these are very important traits. Herbert's size would make him the tallest starting NFL quarterback. It's also important to note that Herbert was given the keys at Oregon very young with a breakout age of just 18 and a half, which puts him at a 99th percentile breakout age. So the other that could be vying for the second quarterback off the board is Tua. Of course, without his injury concerns, he would probably be the number one selection in this draft. He just had insane production at Alabama and just showed all the tools that you would want in a quarterback. The mocks mostly had Tua going 6th overall to the Chargers, and the latest that he was going was 9th overall to the Jaguars. Tua is a prototypical pocket passer, so he doesn't have the ability with his legs that Herbert and Joe Burrow have. But his decision-making and accuracy make him very effective. Another important thing to point out is Tua's size. Right now, the only starting quarterback in the NFL that's shorter than Tua is Russell Wilson. Tua's breakout age is a little bit older, but also you have to remember he was playing at Alabama and he's not getting credit for breaking out and winning the national championship for Alabama, since that is a full season breakout age. Once we sort out the order that the first 3 quarterbacks go, the next important thing to look for is who is the first receiver drafted. There are a handful of receivers that could be up for this, but it's most likely to be Jerry Jeudy. Right now, the most likely landing spot would be the Raiders. The Raiders are mocked to take a receiver in almost every mock that you can find out there. And Jeudy is one that they have been linked to as being really interested in. One thing to point out is how young Jerry Jeudy is. Right here, it's showing 21, but he actually doesn't turn 21 until this Friday. Jerry Jeudy is great at creating separation and doing this with precise route running. Jerry Jeudy should be able to line up inside and outside and excel at hand fighting and getting open in the NFL. Close on Jerry Judy's tail is CeeDee Lamb of Oklahoma. Many see him as the most well-rounded receiver in this draft class. He plays with the balance and focus and strength in all facets of the game. He can fight and win for a ball at the catch point, and he has eye popping after the catch. We should expect CeeDee Lamb to be selected somewhere between 11 and 13. There's a bunch of teams that are very wide receiver needy, and I would not be surprised at all to see CeeDee Lamb get drafted before Jerry Jeudy. They're very neck and neck at this point, and it's really a preference of which type of receiver you want. Maybe the more well-rounded in CeeDee Lamb or the more eye-popping in Jerry Jeudy. It really could come down to whatever an executive was really looking for. One other thing to point out on this page is that you'll see there above the picture that it says the PPI. What that means is how many people on Player Profiler are looking at this particular page. So CeeDee Lamb is actually the second most viewed page on all of Player Profiler. People are very interested in learning about his workout metrics and his production in college. So there is one other receiver that could be vying for the role of being the first one drafted on Thursday night. Now, we've already talked about CeeDee Lamb and Jerry Jeudy, but Henry Ruggs is also very high in that consideration, and that's because he has a very particular skill set. Henry Ruggs has the fastest raw speed in the draft. And so a lot of people are thinking that maybe his tactical value might be better than his production that they're looking for, someone that can take the top off of the defense. So we could see teams that are looking for that particular trait, and he might actually be the first one drafted overall, even though we might be seeing much more production from the other two. Looking at the workout metrics, you can see the speed that I'm talking about. He's 90th percentile in all three, a 40-yard dash, speed score, and burst score. Right now, the most likely place for Henry Ruggs to be drafted is to the Broncos at 15th. Not only could we be looking at Ruggs taking the top off the defense, but he's also could be lethal at slants and getting the ball on jet sweeps to manufacture some touches. After those top three, we have a little bit of a tier break. The next receiver off the board is anyone's guess, but the most likely is Justin Jefferson from LSU. Jefferson is looked at as a very well all-around player, but he doesn't really have the traits of a true alpha receiver. A lot of people have mentioned that he would be probably best suited as a number two receiver, but still we could be looking at very capable receiver at that. If you look at his most comparable player up there in the top right-hand corner, it's Reggie Wayne. Reggie Wayne joined the NFL and he was a number two receiver to Marvin Harrison, having many, many years of production before becoming one of the best receivers in the NFL further into his career. He's very useful at short and intermediate level targets, especially out of the slot or bunch formations. Justin Jefferson can work the middle of the field and gobble up easy catches with his separation and timing, but he doesn't really have much of a vertical threat. The analysts have Justin Jefferson going in a very wide range, starting as early as the Broncos at 15 and all the way in the Packers at 30th, but all five of our mocks had Justin Jefferson going in the first round. The NFL is looking for the next Patrick Mahomes, and some people are hoping that they can find that with Jordan Love. But reality has to set in that Patrick Mahomes was something special. You see here that the best comparable player for Jordan Love is Dan Orlovsky, which anyone drafting Jordan Love in the first round might not be that excited about. However, he has a lot of athleticism and he has some off-script game heroics the same way that Patrick Mahomes does. But his decision-making, Sigmund Bloom calls it kind of a mess. Right now, you're looking at kind of a developmental quarterback, and if someone takes him towards the latter half of the draft, they're really hoping that they can hit big on something that probably might not or will definitely not be Patrick Mahomes, but they're hoping that it's something that looks like what being successful in the new NFL. The next receiver we're going to talk about is Brandon Ayuk of Arizona State. Sigmund Bloom says that Ayuk can contribute right away on screens, manufactured touches, and punt returns. You also notice that his breakout age is a little bit worse than a lot of the other receivers that we're talking about. Two things to consider here is that Ayuk spent 2 years at a JUCO, and then he transferred to Arizona State, and N'Keal Harry was the alpha dog there his junior year. So he only had 1 year where he was the top receiver. So then it really took his last year to break out. A lot of people in the, you know, metrics community take a big knock on these kind of things. They like to see their receivers break out at a younger age. But if you kind of look at those kind of characteristics, you know, maybe you could forgive the fact that he was a little bit older when he broke out. One drawback is that he might really only be able to play in the slot because he'll have trouble getting releases against press coverage. So that is something that is a little bit limiting, but still a very dynamic player. Next up is T. Higgins from Clemson. You'll notice that T. Higgins is the tallest receiver that is projected to go into the first round. He has a lot of length, but he still is a fluid athlete. He has explosive acceleration. He should be excellent on back shoulder throws, and Sigmund Bloom thinks that he's best paired with a quarterback that can throw a receiver open. Now, the idea here is that there are some quarterbacks that are see it, throw it. So they have to see that you're open before they throw you the ball. And there are some that can anticipate your movement, your athleticism, and your ability at the catch point. And so Sigmund Bloom says that he really needs to get paired with a quarterback who can throw a receiver open, that can throw more of a, I guess you'd say, like a Josh Allen YOLO ball. We love first round running backs. As the years have gone on, they've become less and less. And right now we're looking at maybe one coming off the board. There's still some question about who that will be. The only running back that was mocked in any of the five drafts that I looked at was DeAndre Swift of Georgia. The landing spot that would get everybody excited would be if he went to the Kansas City Chiefs. I think that people would start drooling over what he could be in that system and with that explosive offense. Sigmund Bloom says that Swift runs with competitive toughness and has a second gear, but not a fifth gear. He's not sudden, but he can elude low contact and make subtle adjustments at speed effectively. He's a smooth receiver, but he lacks the snap to be anything more than someone that's getting targeted on outlets or screen plays. The last receiver that we'll talk about is Laviska Shenault. He has a big, imposing frame and is great at creating separation. He's a natural, fearless runner after the catch, and he should get some touches on jet sweeps or as a running back. One of the unknowns is his route running, and more importantly, he has some spotty durability. He did get cleared from an off-season injury, so he should be all right, but I know that this is scaring away a lot of GMs. Recently, a poll of NFL GMs labeled Laviska Shenault as most likely to bust from this draft class. It seems a little harsh, considering that this is all just probably based on these injuries that he's working back from, but it's also something to be concerned with a little. As you can see here, only one of the mocks had Shenault drafted in the first round, so we should probably not expect him to be drafted. It would be really interesting, though, if he did go to the Packers and he was playing off of Davante Adams. That would be an incredible pairing. And the only position we haven't talked about is the tight end. Now, right now, it does not look like a tight end will be drafted in the first round. And there was only one tight end that was mocked in the first round, and it was Harrison Bryant. Now, most people will have never heard of this guy. He played at Florida Atlantic University, and most people don't consider him the best tight end in this class. But Peter Schrager did mock him to the New England Patriots at the 23rd overall pick. Now, he could be a viable move tight end. He has good enough hands and acceleration, but he's not a dynamic athlete, and he really won't add anything after the catch. If he gets drafted in the first round, it's strictly as somebody who fits well in what the Patriots are trying to do as they're trying to fill that position after Rob Gronkowski retired. All right, I wanted to end this video just looking at some of the props, the prop bets that I had looked at. Team to draft Tua right now. You've got negative 150 for him to go to Miami. I don't know that it's likely, but there was recently a Roto World blurb that came out that said that there was a lot of discussion from the Dolphins GM that they were not going to be drafting Herbert, which is right now where everyone is mocking Herbert too is to the Dolphins. So, you know, that could just be coach speak. It could just be that GM trying to throw everyone off of what they're trying to do so that someone doesn't try to jump them and take the person that they want. But right now, you know, this is an interesting bet to make. First receiver off the board, we talked about that. There are three receivers that could really be vying for that between Judy, Ruggs, and CeeDee Lamb. Right now, Lamb's getting +160. So that could be kind of interesting. Right now, I would probably see that. I think that Judy or Lamb will be that first receiver off the board. I know that a lot of people have been talking about Ruggs, but I don't see him as being the type of person that someone's going to try to jump somebody to get. I could see that. I could see teams trading up to get either of those two guys. So, you know, with that considered, and with the fact that CeeDee Lamb is the most well-rounded receiver, I could really see that being a really good wager at this point. Another one that's really interesting is where will Jordan Love get drafted? I pulled this off of an article from Sportsline, And it's got 16 and a half. All the mocks that I look at have Jordan Love getting drafted after 16 and a half. I wonder if that's been changed. I was trying to check this morning. I couldn't find any updated lines. I don't see anyone drafting Jordan Love before 16 and a half. I think it's going to be over. And I would expect that this number has moved. This is what it was at when I was looking at it. Another one is the total receivers being drafted in round one. Everyone knows that there's a lot of receivers. There's a lot of really great receivers in this draft. But sometimes when you have so many really, really good receivers, that could, you know, tempt teams to wait and try to get one in the second and third round because there's going to be so many that are available. There's only, you know, four, I think, that I talked about that were really, really difference makers with the big three. And then I would put Justin Jefferson in that category, even though he's not someone that looks like a true alpha receiver at this point. He's someone that could become that and someone that would be a really, really strong number two. And then you've got a whole bunch of guys that are really good, but do they differentiate themselves enough from the next five or so receivers? So, you know, five, I think that everyone's saying, yeah, five, those four, and then another one. But then the sixth one is the one that is hard to pick up. We talked about a bunch of them that could be there. It kind of just comes down to what do you believe? The fact that there's a lot of really good ones, does that mean that they'll get drafted early? Or does that mean that people will or teams will be willing to wait and get a really good receiver? Another one. Will there be a running back in the first round? So right here we see it's 0.5. So that's basically saying, yes, there is one. No, there's not one. Again, we've seen kind of the falling off of the first round running back, but we have had first round running backs in the recent draft. So, you know, to see one of them last year, we had Josh Jacobs. The year before we had a couple. We'll see how that goes. Again, there's a handful of them there with Jonathan Taylor, J.K. Dobbins, Clyde Solaire, and then also Swift. You got four there that a lot of people are talking about. Cam Akers is there as well. Those guys will fall somewhere probably in the second to third rounds, but one of them might make it into the first. And then lastly, we talked about Harrison Bryant. We talked about how it's not likely that he'll be drafted in the first round, but there still is the question of who is going to be the first tight end selected, and he's got a shot. Right now he's 16-1. I would guess that this number has come down just because people have been talking about this Peter Schrager mock draft. I just randomly picked Peter Schrager, and I saw this in there, and I'm like, oh, that's kind of interesting. And then I listened to Establish the Run, and they were specifically pulling out this Peter Schrager mock draft and just saying, oh, this guy's really sharp. So maybe this is something. So not only has this been highlighted in a Sportsline article and on this, and then also in the Establish the Run podcast. So this number has definitely have to have come down. But you know, right now it's kind of a up in the air of who will be the first tight end drafted. All right, I want to thank you for watching my video. For everyone in the league, please remember that by Wednesday you have to make your drops. So please go ahead and do that before the draft. And thanks. Definitely would very much appreciate feedback. This is the very first time I've done anything like this. Any kind of feedback you have, it would be greatly appreciated. Have fun on Thursday, guys. And talk to you later.